So thank you all for being here today. And the picture here, I chose it because it gives the idea. I don't know how many of y'all are familiar with the rumor game. A lot of times people will play it in grade school, something like that. The teacher or one of the students will start off by telling one story to one student. That student will then pass on to another student, and so forth and so on. Usually what will wind up happening is by the time it gets to the last student, you typically get some type of funny rendition of what the original message was supposed to be. And the reason why I picked it, because why does it matter? It matters because of scale. In that particular setting, again, the consequences are relatively small. When you blow that up to larger social settings and environments, what you have is, what I like to think of is the narratives that we tell each other. We create these stories, we share these stories, and we continue to create them and modify them and change them as we interact with people on a regular basis. So in this particular case, my research was a rhetorical analysis based on an event that that took place at a local library. The incident itself, there was a fight that took place between high school students. The library staff quickly got involved, and then police were called. The fight was ended relatively quickly. The students then left out of the building, or they were escorted out of the building by the officers. And initially, that was the end of it. Unfortunately, some of the students came back, which was apparently against what the officer had previously said. And the officers returned to the scene. And ultimately, I want to say one student was arrested and another adult who was unidentified originally as having any kind of basis of being there was also arrested. The lens that I chose to analyze this incident was an idea put forth by Kenneth Burke in his book Grammar of Motives, which he published in 1945. In it, his idea was that he wanted to figure out why do we do the things that we do, and some of the motivations behind it. And in order to work, it's not working. So in order to analyze that, the main idea that he put forth was called a pinhead. So essentially five key components that make up in the center of the motivation. So you have the act itself, the actors, which I'm not sure if it's like that, but the actors, the scene in which it takes place, the agency, and the purpose, each of which have their own corresponding meanings. And the question that I wanted to ask when I wanted to analyze the situation was, what is the role of dominant narratives and communications about encounters between police and citizens? It was sparked by the artifacts that I had available to me, the main one being a social media post that was put up by one of the parents of one of the children that were present when the incident took place. In that social media post, the parent made the argument that first, she was disgusted by the action of the police in terms of their handling of the situation, but then furthermore, that in her opinion, that it would have been handled differently had the students been of a different race. In this particular case, the students were children of color. I did take issue with that, only for the reason that I think at that point it creates more of a straw man argument, because there's no real way of understanding and making that argument without it actually being the case. The artifacts that I had beyond that were the security footage that I was able to get access to from the incident that took place, which captured various scenes. The police report, which includes a narrative account from one of the officers who is listed in it as being injured during the incident. And it was surprisingly simple to get the police report, which is what I didn't expect that part. But the act itself, of course, has already been identified as the fight. But then the social media post acts as its own separate act. And the reason for that is because, as I'm sure y'all are familiar with the idea of virality and how certain ideas can kind of take on a life of their own once they make it to social media in various places. So, and a lot of times what unfortunately happens is whether or not they've been verified as being true or false, they can become the narrative that, that gets told and shared and decimated most people. So the actors would be the students, the officers, and the parent. The agency, the scene, would be the library, which it took place at, and social media. Because again, once it's there, it takes on a life of its own, because we all have our own networks of friends. They have their networks of friends, and very easily, by hitting one button to share it, it immediately becomes part of a larger community. The agency is how each actor behaves. And so I want to spend some time here, because I think that's between agency and purpose is where we really get to understanding more about the role of those dominant narratives. So how did each of those actors behave? First, we have the students who initially left the premises at the request of the officers, but then returned back. So we have an issue here of whether or not they see authoritative figures, or they see officers as being persons that are deserving of respect, and whether or not that's always deserved, it's still something that needs to be considered, especially when situations go negatively, as they did in this particular case. The officers also have some of the consideration you made, because some of the research that I did in preparation for the study found that there is this idea that depending on how officers interact with citizens, it can drastically affect the nature of which and the way they take place. So generally speaking, if the officer or authoritative figure or law enforcement behaves in such a way that is respectful and honoring of that person, typically it's found that you have more positive interactions. Obviously, in this particular case, the opposite is also true. And generally speaking, whenever the officers would engage with students, in particular with the study that I researched, they would have negative outcomes. And oftentimes it would be cited as the disposition of the officer, not necessarily their actions. And then the parent. Again, because it is social media, because it lacks that filtration tool like you would in journalism or editorial work, there is no way to check the sources, so to speak, before it becomes information. In this particular case, I followed it shortly after, and it did not, I think at most it reached maybe 10 to 20 comments, give or take, but it never got beyond that point. And there were no videos that were posted. So this was a relatively small event in terms of social media. And so finally, the purpose, which is the why. So the why is the larger question. It's all good. I don't know. So the purpose. Yeah. The purpose will be the why, and that's understanding more so the questioning of what motivates people to act in the way they do. And I firmly believe that that's a function of the narratives that we're telling. And so in large part, I believe that the students, being younger people, are being given a narrative that associates law enforcement and authoritative figures as being obstructive, intrusive, and creating barriers to their self-expression. And therefore, it makes it okay to then go against that. For the officers, I think they're being given a narrative that young people can be seen as threats inherently without necessarily taking into account these persons' idiosyncrasies. And for the parent, I think operating under the guise that, again, the officers are acting as a militaristic force based on popular narratives attributed to the outcome of this incident. So that's it.